Hello, everybody. Welcome in to the Apples and Genos Fantasy Hockey Podcast. My name is Nate Grootniblink. I'm the creator of Apples and Genos, originator of the Zero G Draft Strategy. And in this podcast, Blake and I are going to continue our 8-episode series in which we go team by team comparing notes on our projections for the 2024-2025 season. Let's get it. And of course, I have your friend and my best friend, my Blake. So, something's gone wrong with my notes here. It says my one, my only, my everything. What's happening?
How does it feel? All right, that's the most important question, Nate. How does it feel when the words leave your lips? Does it feel right?
Surprise. It feels right, I have to
Well, there you
admit.
go. All right, well, that's nice. Buddy, how you doing?
I'm doing all right, man. I guess we'll get into it. Like, I don't know how to segue into this, but just unbelievable, terrible news that we got today about Johnny Gaudreau and his brother Matthew, struck by a drunk driver and killed yesterday. And yeah, leaving behind wives, kids, the whole nine yards. Just one of the bigger tragedies we've had to endure as a hockey community in general. Yeah, just thinking of obviously your own family in times like this, and just cannot imagine what the family's going through at this time. And so all our thoughts and prayers go out to the family for sure. There is a GoFundMe that's been started for Matthew Gaudreau, Johnny Gaudreau's brother, for his surviving wife and child. If it's within your means to help out there, that's obviously going to be a good cause. They've already raised $230,000, which is fantastic stuff. Glad to see the hockey community can support something like that. But yeah, Blake, I don't know if you've got anything else to say, but yeah, tough day to be a hockey fan for sure.
That was just a gut punch. It really was. Because obviously news came out last night, kind of in an inappropriate, weird manner. And then there was hope that it wasn't true, but turns out it was. So yeah, it's a hard day. And we're here doing fantasy hockey, which is a game that we love, and we'll continue to do that and hopefully bring a little levity to your day and have some fun while we do it. But yeah, just hard not to think about Johnny Gaudreau, Matthew Gaudreau, and their families at this time.
All right. Well, with that in mind and in our hearts, I guess we'll continue on with the purpose of this particular episode. That's to continue our projection series. We're starting with Florida. We actually have some pretty interesting teams lined up for this group. We're going in reverse alphabetical order, which gives us Florida, Edmonton, Dallas, and Detroit in this particular one, which is going to be pretty sweet. But let's get into it. Let's talk about the key departures here. Some pretty key ones. Brandon Montour, the biggest one for sure here. Oliver Ekman-Larsson, two key defensemen off the Stanley Cup winning roster here, and also backup goaltender Anthony Stolarz. Key additions here, you've got Adam Boqvist. We've got the incoming rookie Mackie Samuskevich, and Nate Schmidt was also signed to fill one of those defenseman roles. Any overarching thoughts? Like, it's hard to not view this as a bit of a decline for the Panthers' overall roster.
Yeah, definitely a downgrade, but I mean, who the hell cares? They just won the cup. Oh my God. They can do whatever the hell they want for the next 10 years. And the fans will be like, remember the good old days in 2024 or whatever, So it's definitely a downgrade. On the back end, there's going to be some interesting questions for the Panthers for sure.
All right. Let's talk about coaching. Obviously, Paul Maurice not going anywhere after winning the cup. He returns. I think it was like 26 seasons he's gone on, and this is his first cup. So congrats to Paul Maurice, finally gets there. Yeah, one of the best coaches in the league for fantasy, right?
He's such a beauty too. Like, I remember his interview after they won the Stanley Cup. Like, this guy is amazing. He's talking about Winnipeg fans, and he's just seems like a very authentic, genuine guy. And something that that you've said in the past, and I absolutely agree with, is this guy has adapted to the league, right? He's not a guy that just my way or the highway. Like, he has adapted in this league, and obviously he's found the ultimate success here in Florida. So yeah, this is it's great for fantasy as well. I think we'll know exactly what to expect, save for a few little questions maybe on the power play.
Maybe on the power play. Terrific segue skills there, Blake. Thank you for your service.
Okay.
True top power play unit, obviously, in Florida. You got some locks. You got Barkov. You got Tkachuk. You got Reinhart. Rahegi was there all last season. Don't see that one changing. But realistically, we do have a big question opening up on the back end now with the loss of Brandon Montour, who was obviously the power play quarterback for the majority of the last 2 years, when healthy, pretty much was that guy. So, question to you, Blake: Forsling, Ekblad, or the newcomer Adam Boqvist to be the new power play quarterback?
Yeah, I mean, we're going to definitely get into this a little bit in the meat of our Florida talk here. But to me, I think Ekblad is it's his spot to lose. That's my opinion. He has been there before. He's done it before. But it's so strange. Yeah, like Montour gone, OEL gone. Those were the two guys on the power play last year. So it is a really interesting situation. And it's kind of wide open, isn't it? Like, you could make an argument for all three of those players, Forsling, Ekblad, and even Boqvist. I mean, where are you leaning right now, Nate?
Yeah, right now, obviously, we have no news at this point as we're recording this. We'll get news, obviously, when they start camp and we get to see them run some power play units. Jameson Olive, I believe, is the Florida beat reporter that's the most active on Twitter, and he's really good with tweeting out lines and stuff like that. So I do think we'll actually get a good idea of what they're running in camp at some point here. So I will be keeping a really close eye on that for this in particular. But in my mind, like, it feels like they tried to make Ekblad this guy, and then they went away from him on purpose. They were really happy to go with Montour. Even when Montour is out, they made it OEL. It really feels to me like they're trying for it not to be Ekblad, and I can see why, because honestly, like, his numbers are not great on the power play whenever he's been there. Forsling, I think, could be great on the power play, but they've literally never tried him there. Like, he's been a step behind Ekblad in the pecking order throughout. So, yeah, I mean, if you told me right now Forsling was the guy, then I'd be like, man, we should be drafting Forsling way, way, way higher, because I do think he's terrifically talented, not only defensively, but untapped offensive potential. Actually kind of reminds me a little bit, this is going back a bit, but Duncan Keith, when he first came into the league, he was behind some guys, and there's a lot of talk about, like, man, he's like really good, but like, he's not getting a lot of offensive minutes here, not a lot of power play time. And then when he got it, he just exploded. I think that's a potential, something that could potentially happen for Forsling. The underlying numbers are there. But Boqvist feels like, again, just the kind of guy you go out and you get a guy for one job and one job only, and that's to run the power play, because he doesn't play defense really. Yep. So that's who I'm going with right now. We'll get into the numbers and some more talk about that, but that's who I'm going with. That's the way I've projected it at the moment. I haven't projected it with a high degree of confidence. I'm not like saying like 3.5 minutes of Adam Boqvist.
No, we're going to edit this. We're going to edit this part out. The main thing I'm hearing here is Adam Boqvist power play one, folks.
Yeah, that's it for sure. All right, let's dig into it. Let's start with the forwards, though. Let's get through the obvious ones. Barkov at the top, I have for 32 goals, 57 assists, 89 points. You have for 31 goals, 59 assists, 90 points. I think Barkov is just one of the most bankable fantasy assets. You're in, you're out. Do you think he could even score a few more goals? Last year, it seemed like he really was just deferring to Reinhart. It was the right move. I think Barkov makes the right move 99.9% of the time that he's on the ice, and that's why he's so good, and that's why he centered and captained a Stanley Cup winning team. I just feel so confident every time I'm picking Barkov. We talked about Jack Eichel being like that click that you love to make in the third round. I feel like Barkov is a similar player in a lot of respects, in that, and just the way you feel about him when you draft him like in the third round or something like that.
Yeah, just solid. The floor is insane here. I mean, obviously, obvious big difference between Eichel and Barkov is the shot total, right? Like, yeah. like that's one of the things I love about Eichel. And it's, I love Barkov too. This was a third round guy that I got in a lot of spots last year. And it's weird in the mock drafts I've done on Yahoo and in the best balls that we've been doing and in some other leagues I've been in as well. Barkov's, he's hitting the fourth round. I mean, Barkov in the fourth, I mean, you got to smash that. You know, it obviously he's center only. So that is maybe part of it, but I'm a big fan of Barkov. Like you said, he's sort of been deferring to Reinhardt there. And obviously that was a great move. They just won a cup and Reinhardt had 57 goals. They went off. That's the only thing with Barkov where I'm like, okay, I don't know if that comes back. Like his, you know, his shots on goal per 60 at even strength, it's, you know, over the past two seasons, it's gone down by a full two shots, right? Mm-hmm. Which is, it's not awesome, you know, but his scoring chances have remained the same and everything else is good to go. But I'm not sure those shots come back. Like they don't need him to do that when you got a guy like Reinhardt out there and Verhaeghe as well, if they end up lining up that way. So anyways, long story short, Barkov is an amazing fantasy asset and I think he's worth the third round pick. Like if you, you know, same that we talked about with Eichel, if you get two wingers or a winger and a defenseman in your first two picks, and then you got Barkov sitting there in the third round, like bang, smash that. I think that's going to feel really good. If he gets to the fourth, it's again, just get the commissioner to e-transfer you the winnings immediately. All right. That's what Barkov does. He's a beauty.
Yeah. Yahoo ADP 51.4. So early fifth round, like insane value there. Absolutely love that price. Carter Verhaeghe next up, 41 goals for me, 39 assists, 80 points. You have him for 39 goals, 37 assists, 76 points. Again, feel like he's got the power play locked in now, which was the element that was missing for previous years. Mm-hmm. He pretty much solidified that last year. I can't see any reason really why they'd go away from that this year, considering how well it worked overall. Yeah, I feel really confident about clicking on Carter Verhaeghe this year as well.
Yeah, it's weird because I feel like there's almost a little bit of headroom there. Like this guy in 2022-23 got 73 points in 81 games with minimal power play time. And then this recent season, he got another minute of power play time on ice and he had less points, right? But he paced for more. So yeah. I feel like there, you know, he was a little bit inefficient with his shooting percentage, but Florida was overall as a team. Like they had a expected goals for was 11th. In the yep. league, and they ended up with 23rd in the league in goals for. So that's, you know, that's at even strength, I think. But yeah, I mean, I think if this team can be a little bit more efficient, right? Carter Verhaeghe could maybe even hit past, you know, the 73 that he got two seasons ago.
For sure. Yahoo ADP there, 56.9. You're getting him in the mid to late fifth there. Absolute smash there. No Bang. Questions asked. Sam Reinhart coming off that monstrous, 57 goals last year?
Oh, my.
42.5 goals, 42.6 assists for me. That comes out to 85 points. You have him for 41 goals, 45 assists, 86 points. I think we see this pretty similarly. Obviously, the regression bet coming to smack Sam Reinhart around a little bit because of that sky-high shooting percentage that he had last year. But this is a guy who is a legitimate high-percentage converter. Like, I have him, I don't know what you've got him for, Blake, but I have him regressing all the way down to 18% shooting this year, which is obviously still terrific. So I'm still in on Sam Reinhart in general. It's just going to be a question of, does he go too high now based off that season? I think the answer is probably going to be yes, especially in more casual leagues. But I'm not doubting the player, basically.
Yeah, I think we saw ceiling Reinhardt last year. Everything was funneling through him. He was at the end of every pass, and he was converting at a ridiculous rate. So yeah, 24.5%. That's not real. Okay, you got him for 18%. I think I've got him for 17.4%, which is, yeah, I mean, that's a regression. But I think this is a player and a team that is sort of defined his role a little more clearly. Like if you remember in 2022-23, Reinhardt and Verhaeghe were sort of kind of battling for minutes on the power play. And, you know, yeah, ultimately Reinhardt won there. But like, I remember just during the season, it was sometimes between the two of them. And maybe that was even three seasons ago. But this team right now knows exactly what they have in Reinhardt. They know exactly how to get him cooking on the power play, like 27 power play goals. Sheesh. That's insane. And that's going to be an interesting piece when we start talking about the defensemen here, because with their power play, right? Like Brandon Montour, the outgoing Brandon Montour, He was a really good facilitator, but his big year with the power play was because he was shooting a lot more. This last season on the power play, he didn't shoot as much, and they used more of the overload, like the three forwards in the corner, sort of cycling it, right? So will Florida go with Aaron Ekblad, who's a big-time shooter from the point, or will they go with someone like an Adam Boqvist, who's more of a facilitator, right? It's kind of an interesting conversation, but I don't see how you go away from, utilizing Sam Reinhart the way they did last year on the power play.
For sure. Yeah. If it's not broke, you're not going to fix it, especially when it's not broke to the tune of 27 power
Good
play goals.
God.
Going on to the second line there, Sam Bennett rather is the center, 26 0.5 goals I have him for, 25.4 assists. That comes out to 52 points. You have him for 25 goals, 28 assists, 53 points. Pretty solidified role at this point for Sam Bennett. He's like the next guy up in terms of the forwards for the power play. Always going to get there with the shots, with the hits. He does that. Penalty minutes, if that's your thing in your league. I think he's just a really solid, consistent guy, really good in bangers. I feel like really locked in. If you can't tell so far, I feel like really locked in on my Florida projections. Yeah, yeah. We're pretty tight across the board here through this forward group. I just feel really confident about what these guys bring to the table.
It's weird. They just won the Stanley Cup, but like I said, their efficiency at even strength was pretty damn awful, and they still won, right? So what if that gets just a little bit better? Now, we're looking at more production for all of these players, right? Or all at least the ones we're talking about, right? And Sam Bennett included. This guy's a chucker to the extreme, buddy. I just thought of Vanilla Ice. To the extreme, I rock a mic like a Vandal, light up a stage. Oh, God. Do you know who Vanilla Ice is, Nate?
I am aware of Vanilla Ice, yes.
All right, you like him. Don't pretend. All right, that's fine. We'll take that offline. But anyways, Sam Bennett Ice, and this is a guy that is a metrics guy. We love that, but his efficiency is terrible. And his shots did kind of decline last year. So hopefully those go up, the efficiency on the team goes up, and he can get over that 50 point range.
Absolutely. Matthew Tkachuk, next up, I have for 35 goals, 61 assists, 96 points. You have him for 38 goals, 60 assists, and 97 points, I guess, with the round down there. So again, pretty much in lockstep. I think people will be potentially projecting a little bit more for Matthew Tkachuk in some spots, like trying to get him back up to that 100 plus point pace that he'd been on before. And I really think, for me at least, the reason that I don't see that coming is the season before in Florida, he skated 15:36 at even strength. Last year was down to just 14:16. Even if it rebounds this coming season, I do have it rebounding up to 14 minutes, 30 seconds at even strength. He also had an extra 28 seconds on the power play that year. Like, everything went right. He had like the most deployment in all the best spots. Everything went right for him to get over that 100 point mark in terms of deployment. And I feel like Maurice is just like, I probably don't need to absolutely run these guys down. We're still winning games. We're going to make the playoffs. We don't have to be the one seed necessarily. This is going to work, even if I don't play Matthew Tkachuk every single minute possible. I think that's maybe part of the evolution of Paul Maurice as a coach that really helped them get over the hump last year. He was coming off the injury last year coming into the season, so maybe that factors into it. Maybe he does go all the way back up. So there is still upside, I feel like, from this number, just based on deployment alone. If Maurice does overuse him, like maybe the bottom six is just really bad this year. They did overhaul the bottom six a fair bit in Florida, and maybe they have to use the top six even more. That's a possibility. I feel really confident in Tkachuk at this number, with even a little bit of upside for more.
Yeah, definitely. I think you hit the nail right on the head. The injuries, I think, played a big factor, especially in his efficiency, right? I mean, this guy broke his sternum, for God's sake. Like take a season off, my man. And they still won the Stanley Cup, like his assists were pretty consistent, but it's the goals that really fell off. But if you look before that, he had two 40 goal plus seasons, right? So I think the efficiency is going to come back, and that's where I'm seeing the 97 points. But I think you're absolutely right as well. Like, they don't need to put this guy out there. I noticed at times during the year, like, he was kind of a secondary option. You know what I mean? Like, they were getting the Barkov line out there, right? Yeah. And getting to Biz there. And this guy was, he still played like 18 minutes, 38 seconds, but that's 2 minutes almost less than he played the year previous. So I think you're absolutely right about that. They've got a proven formula now. They just won the cup. This guy was fresh as a daisy in the playoffs, looked very good. So yeah, I think 90 points is floor, in my opinion.
Yep. Next up, Evan Rodriguez, the projected remaining member, I guess, of the top six there. I have for 15 goals, 24 assists, 39 points. You have for 18 goals, 26 assists, 44 points. I don't think I'll be drafting Evan Rodriguez. Like, I have him at a projected for a 7.8 shooting percentage. He is one of the worst converting shooters across the entire league. He is an absolute chucker in the strongest sense of the word. Yeah, I don't know how we can work Chucker into Rodriguez into the last name there, but I'll let you workshop that one, Blake. I just am not excited about Rodriguez. Like, yeah, you can stream him if he's on that line, but the likelihood that he stays there all season is almost nil, in my opinion.
Yep. I mean, this is your one of your top Florida streamers, right? After Sam Bennett, this guy is probably next in line. I mean, you got Anton Lundell, you got a couple other guys there, but I'm interested in Evan Rodriguez as a streamer. And look what he did in the finals. All right. Damn, this guy saved his best. He saved his efficiency for the Stanley Cup finals, right? And he potted a bunch of goals in there. So yeah, he's landed in a nice spot. And, you know, I'm not 100% sure that Verhaeghe does get that line with Barkov and Reinhardt. Like, yeah, Erod spent a bunch of time up there too. So I think they were rolling with Verhaeghe there in the playoffs. So that kind of makes me think that Verhaeghe is going to get that deployment. But either way, this guy's in the top six and he's playing with studs. So, I mean, what did I have him for? This is good podcasting here. 44 points. I mean, that's probably ceiling Erod right there. But, you know, he does shoot the puck, and we like that.
That is for sure. One other player that we'll mention here with the projection is Anton Lundell. I had him for 16.5 goals, 24.3 assists, comes out to 41 points. You had him for 17 goals, 22 assists, 39 points. So I actually have Lundell projected for more than Rodriguez, even expecting him to work from the third line, barring injury. I am reasonably high on Lundell. I think there's potential that is maybe untapped here with Lundell. The team obviously believes in him, gave him a huge contract extension, 6-year, 30 mil contract this offseason. They think he's a huge part of their plans and their 2C apparent, I think, after Bennett probably moves on at some point. I think that, yeah, they just think this guy is the real deal. And I tend to agree. I think he's probably one of the better 3Cs across the league. I read some articles about how he struggled with some confidence throughout last year, but really seemed to find his groove as the season went on. Under the hood, he's been like really consistent, even strength, shots per 60 at 8.01 his rookie year, 8.04 the year after, 8.02 last year. So he's been right on the money every single year there. I think, like, this is a guy who's been playing with third line players in Florida. Yep. If Sam Bennett ever goes down to injury, or Barkov goes down to injury or something, and he gets elevated into the top six, I think you're instantly looking at a guy who's like 55 plus point pace as long as he's up there. So I do think that you need to know the name Anton Lundell, and you need to be aware of it if there is an injury or some other reason catapults him into the top six.
Remember the name Anton. All right. Say it with me, folks. Anton Lundell. No, that's terrible. Yeah, I like your take there, that this is maybe they're grooming him for 2C, but that makes me think too, like, this is probably not the year where Anton Lundell is going to be our guy, right? Like, Sam Bennett is, he's a UFA in 2025, 26. So he's got a show me contract. We'll have to see what they want to do there. But I mean, Bennett is he's a mean person. You know what I mean? He's the type of guy you want in the playoffs. Whereas Lundell is a bit more soft spoken, but he's just amazing at puck battles. And he's just all around solid defensively. I love the contract they gave him. That's a lot of confidence there too, right? So yeah, he's a young guy too. So maybe next year, Anton Lundell, I'm a little more in on. This year, yeah, it's going to take an injury for him to be relevant for me.
All right, let's move on to the defenseman. Gustav Forsling, I have for 12 goals, 29 assists, 41 points. You have for 12 goals, 33 assists, 45 points. I think we see this relatively similarly. What did you give him on the power play? I had him for only 45 seconds on the power play because, without injury there, if I'm projecting Boqvist to have a role there, then it's Boqvist and Ekblad, and then Forsling likely just picking up scraps if one or both is injured.
I did some weird stuff just because I don't know what's going on. you know, you made me think twice about Adam Boqvist, because that's not a player that I was like thinking would have anything go on. Like, I projected Boqvist, and we'll talk about him in a second, but I projected him for 30 points, right? Which is a pretty mediocre season, right? But for Forsling, I gave him a minute and a half on the power play. Okay. I bumped him up just a tiny bit. Like, he, you know, in 2022-23, he played a minute and 23. That was his average power play time on ice, which is fine. But there was also, you know, better players there. There was Montour, there was Ekblad, right? And he still got that. Whereas last year, they just said, hey, buddy, go out and stop the puck from going in the net. Can you help us out? Help out Bobrovsky here. And that's what Forsling did. This guy really separated himself from the pack in terms of his defensive ability. Like, if I've never like there's the PDO show, I'll shout them out. They love, you know, Dimitri, he loves Forsling, and he put out on YouTube a little like a reel of Forsling's best defensive plays. And I was like, this is jacking me up. You know what I mean? This guy's amazing. So shout out to that. Definitely go check that out on YouTube. But yeah, I gave him the minute and a half because there's really no one else. Like, and I'm not sold on Boqvist at this point. Right. So I think it's going to be Ekblad, Forsling, but you know, and Boqvist, it's all going to be intertwined, but I think Ekblad is going to be the one getting the most.
All right. So let's talk about Ekblad then. It is one of the bigger discrepancies we have. I have him for 12 goals, 30 assists, 42 points. You have him for 14 goals, 37 assists, 51 points. So yeah, almost a, with the rounding, it's almost a 10-point difference there. So obviously a big chunk of that's going to be power play. How much time did you give him on the power play then? I have him for 2 minutes, 15 seconds.
I gave him, you know, just under 3. So I gave him like 2 minutes and 40 seconds. 2 minutes and 42 seconds, something like that.
So not a huge difference there. And I did project him, yeah, to be with good players for most of it. I have him for the same on ice stats, basically, is what I'll say, as I have for Boqvist. So it's not like I was giving Boqvist a huge bump in terms of the teammate expectation there. So there must be a little bit more of an expectation for you then in terms of IPP or something along those lines. What'd you have for him there?
I think I might be a little hotter on ice shooting percentage. Like, for his IPP at even strength, I've got him at 37%. That's even strength. And
35.
Then 35. Okay, and then on the power play, I've got 51%.
So for 50.
Yeah, I feel like if they're putting Ekblad on the power play, it's because they want shots, right? So we're looking at shots from the point, players banging in rebounds. But on in terms of the power play, because he's going to be on that top unit, in my mind, I gave him 13.8 as an on-ice shooting percentage on the power play.
Okay.
And then I gave him 10.3 at even strength. Sorry, you go ahead.
No, I have him for 10 at even strength and 12.5 on the power play. So definitely a little bit down from you, especially on the power play there. What did you have for the shot generation numbers? I had him for 64 on ice shots per 60 on the power play.
On the power play? Yeah, I've got him for 69.
Okay.
Nice. Oh, yeah. Because that's what they do.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be nice.
That's more than I have for Verhaeghe, Reinhardt, Tkachuk, all these guys, so that would be pretty spicy in my opinion to get there. But I'd love to see it. I think that there's definitely upside here with Ekblad, but I also personally think that he's never really shown us the ability to command a huge portion of the offense. So even if he gets up there, even if the offense is really good, even if the power play is really good, what portion of that pie is he actually garnering for himself? I'm not convinced that Ekblad is that dude. I feel like even in that scenario, that 51 points that you have him for feels to me a little bit closer to the ceiling than to the floor. Do you think that he has much more upside beyond the 51 if he is getting power play time more consistently?
I don't, because he already has, like, I've got him for 20 or no, 19 power play points. So like, I mean, maybe a couple more, but I mean, you know, then you take some away from even strength. I feel reasonable about this projection. Like, this is a player that we were excited about just 3 seasons ago. I mean, he paced for 77 points in 2021-22, right? 15 goals, 42 assists. Like, and that was good. He had a 70% power play share in that year. So I just think that this is a player that still has like a lot of gas left in the tank, actually. And he hasn't, you know, he's been bumped out of opportunity, but opportunity's knocking. And I feel like Ekblad is going to get in there and get the business, right? But it would change that look on that top power play as well. So like you said about Boqvist, I will say the same about Ekblad. Like, I can't project this with any certainty. Like, it doesn't, it doesn't feel good. Like, and so that's why if you're going to draft Ekblad, it's got to be at value. And then the neat thing about Boqvist, which we'll talk about in a minute here, is you don't have to spend any draft capital on that guy. Like, you could pick him up, you could leave him on waivers and just pick him up for the first game. Like, no one's, I don't think people are going out of their way to draft that on Boqvist. So that said, one last thing on Ekblad, I love his ability to score goals, right? I think this is a double digit goal guy from defense. Like, even if, like, what was your projection? It's
I saw 40, him for 42. 12.
Yeah, 42.
12 goals, yeah.
If you got 12 goals and 42 points, like, to me, that's a nice season for Aaron Ekblad. I don't even mind that, right? Because the perks should be okay. And but I do think that's maybe floor. Like, maybe we're bookending what he actually does get.
Sure. Yeah, I think that's definitely possible. Like, you have to expect with Montour out of town, he would, like, for his defensive warts, Montour was a huge even strength minute eater for the Florida Panthers. And so with him out of town, they're definitely going to lean on Forsling Ekblad even more at even strength, in my opinion. So I do think, like, Ekblad didn't actually have a whole lot of time on ice relative to previous seasons last year. He is at 2051 all strengths even time on ice last year. Coming off the injury there as well for Ekblad. So definitely, I think that was a portion of it. But this year, I have him back up to 23. And I think that, yeah, he could even go beyond that. They might really need to lean on Forsling and Ekblad more than they ever have before. So there's definitely some headroom in terms of the deployment there for Ekblad as well. All right, let's talk about Boqvist then. Obviously, the player we have the biggest difference on overall. I have him for 11 goals, 33.5 assists, so it comes out to 44.5 points. You have him for 8 goals, 22 assists, 30 points. Just absolutely despising this man. You are like, but yeah. So I guess I'll say my piece on Boqvist here first. So I have him for 2.5 minutes on the power play. So it's not like I'm giving him the whole kit and caboodle here. I have him for a 64% IPP on the power play, which might be a little hot. It works out to 18 power play points for me if he gets there. Yeah, it could be a little bit hot, but I'm just going back through Boqvist's numbers. Whenever he's been a portion of a power play, he's been impactful on that power play. And he's been impactful in a way that other players have not been able to be impactful. He took over for Werenski in some spots. Columbus was looking for a power play quarterback, and Boqvist was that guy, and he actually ran things and was, a difference maker on that power play. Obviously, I don't think he's going to necessarily be as key to Florida's power play success here, but I do think that he can sustain a relatively high IPP from the back end, closer to what Montour has done in the past, and less like what I would expect Ekblad to do in that situation. So I do think that he has a bigger portion of the pie on the power play if he gets there. So that's what's driving a fair portion of that for me. I also think he's a better offensive talent at even strength. I'm for a little bit bigger IPP there. Have him for the same shot generation, on-ice shot generation as Ekblad, even though he himself personally does not shoot as much as Ekblad does at even strength. I don't think, like, Boqvist is not a guy who's going to give you a ton of shots, a ton of hits, a ton of blocks. So it's definitely more of a points league take with Boqvist here at best. But we're going to find out, I feel like, if Boqvist has a shot for this. And, like, if you're drafting right now, what's it cost you? Like, your last round pick, you pick up Adam Boqvist, you find out. And if he's not good, if he's not going to get that role right out of camp, then you drop him and you move on. So, I feel like having this projection, at least at this point, like the day before September opens and we really get into the meat of fantasy season here, I think that it just makes sense to me to be high on Boqvist at this point. And then if I have to come back off this take when we get some more information out of Florida's camp, then I will.
We'll just edit it in post. Don't worry, Nate. We'll go back in. We'll scrub the tapes. No problem here. I love this take, though. This is a really fun take, and it's exciting. Like, Nate does his homework, folks. Like, this guy knows what he's talking about. So if he's into a player, like, that should – that gave me pause. I'm like, oh, okay. Do I need to start thinking about Adam Boqvist? And so I did. One of the things that I think we do differ on is their even strength production, right? Like, I didn't give him the same on ice numbers as Ekblad because I think Ekblad is going to be playing big minutes with big players. I feel like Boqvist, if he gets power play one, his even strength deployment is going to be third pairing, at best, right? And so that's playing with, you know, guys like who's like, you know, E2 Lewis starring in, and you know, Mackenzie Entwistle. All right. I don't even know. Like, that's a cool name, by the way. But yeah, so like, I feel like it makes sense for his on-ice shooting percentage to be a little bit lower at even strength at minimum. Right. And I did give him, like I said, I gave him 2 minutes, like just over 2 minutes on the power play. So I put him ahead of Forsling, and that was just because of you. seriously. And that's, you know, it should matter. Like if you're saying like, I'm thinking about it. Right. But still, that only equals like 10 power play points for him. You had him for 18. So I think it's really the even strength like area where he can't play defense, and he's a defenseman, you know, so he's not going to be trusted in important situations. He's just not going to get out there. And so, yeah, for that reason, really, I think that's why my projection is a lot lower with this player. But I mean, if he gets power play one, you know, we're looking at a player that could really do something for you for fantasy. But if he doesn't get power play one, I think we're looking at Kalen Addison.
Yep. I think that's definitely within the range of outcomes. I don't think that he's a terrific defensive player. I mean, one more thing I'll just leave it with here, but yeah, nobody thought Brandon Montour was much of anything when he came over to Florida from the Ducks, and he got into a good system and a good place with the Florida Panthers here, and look what he did this offseason, signed one of the biggest deals of the offseason. I'm not saying that's what's going to happen with Boakvist, but like, there's some reason to think that things could go right in a really stable, really good situation for a young defenseman. All right, top three targets for me. Number one, Carter Verhaeghe. I just feel so comfortable making that click. As I mentioned, like mid to late fifth round on Yahoo right now, automatic there. Matthew Tkachuk, as I mentioned, really high base projection with even some potential for more if Maurice decides to lean on him even more. And then had to throw in Boakvist here as my number three just because of that. Obviously, pending camp results here.
Why did you even put him at three? You should have put him at number one, Nate. Come on.
Yeah.
Right. No, we don't do that. Yeah, I kind of wussed out on my top three here with Florida. I got Barkov at number one for obvious reasons. Value being the main one. Like I said, fourth or fifth round. Sheesh. Same with Verhaeghe, right? And again, Verhaeghe, I do think that there's some headway or some headroom there for some more production, right? Because he's got power play one. Like, just get that even strength production back up, just closer to where he was two seasons ago. And you know, we're taking that to the bank. And then Matt Tkachuk as well. I think there's a big bounce back coming there. So yeah, Aaron Ekblad, I would be much more interested in if it wasn't for this conversation we just had.
All right, let's move on. Let's talk about the Edmonton Oilers, the Panthers.
Oh, yeah.
Stanley Cup final opponents. They had some key departures, obviously. Warren Fogle.
Departures.
Okay. It's late, Blake.
It is. Yeah, right? Respect.
Philip Broberg and Dylan Holloway, obviously, with the offer sheets from the St. Louis Blues, they move there. Ryan McLeod moves out in that trade with Buffalo, and then Cody Ceci moves to San Jose. Key additions, obviously they did some spending, tried to shore up the forward group, Jeff Skinner, Victor Arvidsson, and they did bring back Adam Henrique this offseason as well, which is a pretty big one there. First takes, Blake, how do you think this works out? Like, they definitely lost something on the back end, but they definitely added some significant pieces up front. How do you think this all washes out and plays out for fantasy?
I think it's better. I really do. I mean, yeah, their bottom six got even worse, right? It already wasn't very good. And you know what? Who knows? Like, these players who were in the bottom six in Edmonton, there was no chance for them to get any opportunity because of the caliber of players they have there. So maybe these guys are good. Like, Warren Fogle could pop the hell off. Dylan Holloway, let's see. But, you know, what they did do is they shored up their top six, which seems insane. But, like, now Draisaitl isn't playing with Warren Fogle and, you know, Dylan Holloway. He's playing with either Jeff Skinner or Victor Arvidsson or both. I mean, sheesh, that is a major upgrade. So they somehow upgraded their top six in Edmonton. I don't even understand.
Yep. I think for fantasy, you got to be excited about that. Coaching, obviously, Chris Knobloch returns as head coach. Was pretty nervous about this when the coaching change was made, because under the hood, like, everything actually looked pretty good for Edmonton. You can go back and find pods of us talking about that at the time. Like, they were getting horrific results, but doing all the right things under the hood. So we weren't too worried about Edmonton or any of the players that were underperforming at that time. There was some trade McDavid sentiment going around, which was obviously patently
People did
ridiculous.
It, too. I saw some McDavid trades out there. Who was trading McDavid? There's not enough. You can't get enough back.
Yeah, I tried to make a few of those happen for myself, but I wasn't able to get that done. But Chris Knobloch comes in and arguably improves things even beyond where it was. So, yeah, huge fan of his work this past season for fantasy purposes. I don't know if you've got anything beyond that, Blake.
Nothing really, but the only thing I did notice too, especially in the playoffs, is his gamesmanship. This guy's a gamer. He does little things that to help the team win, right? Like he's, you know, taking like sneaky timeouts or like, you know, he has these little tactics that help his team get better. Like this guy's a big time competitor and he's obviously got the results here. He's got the confidence of the room. And I feel like, I mean, Edmonton was so close. I you know, it's a cop out to say there were injuries, but there were some injuries. You know what I mean? Like if these guys were fully healthy and if you had one of Jeff Skinner or Victor Arvidsson in there, like, you know, we're probably looking at the Stanley Cup champions the last year. So I feel really good about Knobloch as coach. And I think we know what to expect moving forward.
Yep. Another place we know what to expect moving forward, the top power play in Edmonton, by and large, the best unit across the league, year in, year out. If you're taking bets, I think you got to put Edmonton right at the top every single year. McDavid, Draisaitl, Nugent Hopkins, Hyman, and Evan Bouchard on the back end. You're not interested in anybody who is coming in as the second power play there. You just can't be interested. There's nothing, no production coming from there. These guys stay on for basically the full 2 minutes every single time. Power play two is lucky to get 20 seconds at the end of it.
They're just happy to be here.
Yeah, exactly. I honestly don't think we need to spend any time here, Blake, do we? All right.
Oh, he didn't give me a chance to answer. I had things to say, Nate. All right, that's fine. Let's move on.
All right. Well, you could say I'm here. We could talk about Connor McDavid. I don't really know what there is to say. I got 43.5 goals, 99.1 assists. Absolutely insane. 142.7 points for me. 44.5 goals for you. 97.7 assists. 142.2 points for you. Is there anything we can say about Connor McDavid that has not already been said?
Just he's hungry. He's really freaking hungry. He's ready to go. Like they were so close. And I feel like what they went through last year is going to galvanize them even more to this season. I mean, you know, I say this now, they could stumble out to a ridiculous start like they did last year, but I just don't see that happening again this year. No. I think they got a taste of it. You got these new guys coming in. You got Knobloch in there. It's all systems go. It's cup or bust this year.
Absolutely. Jeff Skinner, obviously, one of the key additions this offseason that we're very interested in for fantasy purposes. 28 goals, 25 assists, 53 points for me. 24 goals, 27 assists, 51 points for you. I don't think, obviously, there's any power play room for him here, but you could say that maybe he's in line as the next guy up in case of injury. There's other players that would potentially be in line there as well, so you'd have to factor that in. Mm-hmm. But I mean, just being potentially locked in as a left wing alongside McDavid for a full season, like that would be something, wouldn't it, Blake?
Just ask Ty Ratty. All right. It sounds great in theory, and I'm not downplaying this. Like whoever gets to play with McDavid, like Ty Ratty is not Jeff Skinner. This guy has acumen. He shoots, he gets chances, he Julians. He does that, all right? So Skinner is this guy's a real player and he's done some things in this league. So this is an exciting player to play either with McDavid or with Draisaitl. So I think his even strength deployment is, you know, to the moon. This is a really exciting piece.
For sure. Yeah, I will say like Skinner, a legitimate scoring chance and shot generator in his own right at even strength. He doesn't need a center of this caliber to do it for himself, but I think obviously McDavid is going to raise that floor. We have that baked into our projections. The problem here really is that it's so hard to project any sort of bigger role, even at even strength. Like being on the top line sounds terrific, but the top line in Edmonton, like anytime there's a big face-off, like it's going to be Draisaitl and McDavid and Nugent Hopkins that go out there. They're going to take Skinner off for that particular face-off. That happens like 3 or 4 times a game. All of a sudden, you know, I have Skinner projected for only 15 minutes. And I think like that's pretty much the role. I don't think the role is like an 18-minute fully even strength matching McDavid's even strength minutes. Like that role does not exist for this player. If it did, then obviously the projection would be much higher. I do think there's a chance that he is good enough to, hold down a little bit more of that and gets a little bit higher. But by and large, I think you're just looking at a nice piece with Jeff Skinner, who, if he got hot, like I have him at a 13.1% shooting percentage. If he really clicks with McDavid instantly, maybe he shoots 15, 16%, has a really good season, and you get a little bit of an outlier season that way, and that elevates him in terms of fantasy. But that's the kind of route you're looking for. I don't think you're looking at a route here that involves just a massive even strength role.
Yeah. One thing I do want to say on Skinner before we move on there, and you could apply this to Victor Arvidsson as well. Whoever plays with McDavid, like it is as good as that sounds, like, oh, he's playing with McDavid, it's awesome. Like McDavid is the best player in the world and he plays a certain way and no one is wanting him to change that. Right.
Yeah.
So these guys, like, yes, Jeff Skinner is a shot and chance generator on his own. No problem. And he has been his whole career, but like it's not like you can just fit that in with McDavid and hope that he does the same thing. Like he's going to have to alter his game to McDavid's game. And is that going to be a fit? Right. And that's the question. Right. And same with Victor Arvidsson, whoever gets to play with these guys, Draisaitl and McDavid, like they're established and they have a gravity of their own. So it's not just a slam dunk because they're playing with McDavid or Draisaitl.
Yeah. I do think like theoretically it might work. McDavid, obviously the puck possession driver of the line, Hyman, the forecheck guy, and Skinner, the shooter. Like theoretically, that does
Makes
make some
sense.
sense on paper, but obviously in real life, things may happen a little bit differently. Let's talk about Zach Hyman, 46 goals, 39 assists, rounding down to 84 points for me, 45 goals, 35.5 assists, 80.5 points for you. So I'm a little bit higher there. I think we've seen Hyman at this point. We should expect that he's going to be really good. He's not probably going to crest 50 goals again unless he has another shooting percentage year that just is a complete outlier again. He has had a couple of those years, so that's not like insane to think that he could potentially do that again. But I think the safer money is on somewhere around 45 goals and a point per game.
Yeah, I love Hyman. The only thing kind of keeping me from being super excited about Hyman is his IPP on the power play. Like he's just getting in position and banging home a rebound. He's not touching the puck out there. We've seen what they do, right? They go around the outside. McDavid does his thing. He curls back. They do whatever they do. And then Hyman just taps it in, right? His IPP, I projected him for 39% on that power play. Like if he could actually get some points on that power play, like we're looking at a 100-point player almost. But last year, like in their big year, McDavid had 71 power play points in 2022-23. Hyman had 26. They were on for the same amount of time. All right. And then last year he had 15 power play goals and 20 power play points on that lethal power play. So that's kind of what's going to cap his ceiling. And if he isn't uber efficient the way he was last year, those goals are going to fall off a little bit.
Leon Draisaitl next up, 46 goals, 69 assists, nice,
Woo!
115 points for me, 48 goals, 66 assists, 114 points for you. I think this is an interesting point. You've raised it already, Blake, in a few spots. Where do you take Draisaitl at the top of drafts this year? There are some other interesting names who have kind of elevated themselves into this range in terms of point scoring potential. Obviously, Draisaitl, the one with the longest history of scoring in this kind of range, 110 plus point range. So do you go with the history with Draisaitl, obviously coming off a down year last year? What's your take on that scenario in the middle of the first, Blake?
It's an interesting situation for sure, because like I did a Yahoo mock today and he went at 9, Draisaitl at 9, and you can justify it to some weird degree. Like, I don't know. I mean, I think that's a little bit too low for me. I'd rather take him earlier than that, but it kind of made sense. And like one good thing about Draisaitl, he's center left wing on Yahoo. So I think that should bump him up before 9. That's too late. But I mean, again, the power play last year, in their big year, he had 62 power play points. And then that's why everybody's like, oh, he's the clear number two, no question. And then this year he goes for 39 power play points, which is still amazing, but it's, that's quite a big difference. That's a big drop off. So, if he's not getting those massive power play numbers, would you rather have a guy like Kirill Kaprizov? would you maybe take Jack Hughes over him? You know, like we obviously got Pasta, we got Kucherov, you know, Cale Makar even over Draisaitl, maybe, I don't know. So I feel like he's getting faded. And if you're at that 8 or 9 spot and you're getting Draisaitl, damn. I mean, that is a really nice way to start your team because this guy's good to go. Like I think he's good for 40 power play points next year, no problem. So that should bounce back a little bit. He was injured in the playoffs. I don't know. It's a guy that I think you should be super stoked to get. One thing that I am keeping in the back of my mind is like, you know, he might have a little bit of a distraction with this contract extension that's going on. I do buy into that narrative a little bit more than I do for contract years. It's like if they're trying to get a contract and it's like kind of mentally in the back burner while they're trying to go out there and play. Like I've seen players really pop off once they get that contract signed because it's like a mental block is out of the way. So I don't know, just something to think about. But I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if the Oilers get this extension done before the season starts.
Yep. All good points. I do think that Draisaitl kind of is in a tier now where it felt like in previous years he was more in the upper tier, the McDavid, MacKinnon, Matthews tier. Feels like he's now kind of in the tier behind that, the Kucherov, Pasternak. You could talk about any number of the other players that some people may want to elevate up into that tier, but more in that range. And I do think that's legitimate based on this past year. He's always been more of an efficiency guy, and we've seen what happens if the efficiency ticks down, just some bad luck, right? Mm-hmm. He doesn't have the base stats to kind of make up for that as easily as some other players might. And so there is a tiny bit more fragility. Obviously, you know, it's like 105 points versus 120 points. But
what a nice problem to have.
Yeah, exactly. So, and yeah, as you mentioned, center left wing eligibility on Yahoo, getting some of that dual eligibility is always nice. So I think he's squarely in that conversation, and I really wouldn't fault anyone for taking him above any of the guys in that range or below them, to be honest. Okay. Ryan Nugent Hopkins, I think this is possibly the toughest player to accurately project of this group. 25 goals, 56 assists, 81 points for me, 26 goals, 49 assists, 75 points for you. What is your projection on Nugent Hopkins based on here? Because they have toyed around, obviously, with, you know, playing him on the Draisaitl line or playing him as like a 3C, basically. And that is a huge difference for fantasy purposes, a huge difference in terms of the line mates. Playing with Draisaitl versus playing with, who would it be, Adam Henrique? It's obviously going to make a difference in your fantasy totals. So we know the power play role is secure, but what can we reasonably expect in terms of the even strength deployment?
It's a conversation that needs to be had. Absolutely. Like, you know, when you bring in guys like Jeff Skinner and Victor Arvidsson, like, yeah, it's, you know, position could be at a premium, but I just think like we've seen this guy on a line with Hyman and McDavid, and that's where I think he's actually going to play. I think you have Skinner on that top line, but I think it's going to be Skinner and Arvidsson with Draisaitl. But I mean, it, you know, potato, potato. If he's in the top six, we're looking good, right? But yeah, that's absolutely correct. If he's down on the third line, like this even strength production maybe can go out the window. Maybe they want him to play a little bit more shutdown. Like he's very good defensively, and then obviously with his power play time, he's gonna keep his floor rock solid there. But I think he's gonna be in the top six. I think, you know, like the bottom six in Edmonton, like they have Adam Henrique, right? So it's not like they need a center down there. So why not put Nugent Hopkins up on the top two lines and let him cook with the big boys, right? He's done it before. This guy had a 100-point season last year. That's so bizarre. Like, how did he do that? That was just a crazy season. 53 power play points. That's how he did it. but I mean, you know, he had a 69-point pace last year. Very nice. That's the third time. I don't know. There's something going on here. I don't know what we're talking about. I'm just saying words. But yeah, I think there's a definite positive regression coming for Ryan Nugent Hopkins if he can stay in the top six there. I feel good about this player because he's going like very late. I mean, I don't have his Yahoo ADP up here now if you want to look that up real quick, Nate, but I think it's around like 70 or 80, maybe even later. And to me, that's a slam dunk. Like this guy, just the power play access alone at that pick makes total sense, because to me, power play points are a scarce statistic that I sort of covet, especially later in drafts, if you can find someone like this.
So yeah, I just pulled it up. 63.5 is the ADP on Yahoo. So that would be what, the early sixth round?
A little early.
It feels a little bit early, I guess. Obviously, you have to take into account Yahoo's base statistics there, including like plus minus and power play points, which are both things that Nugent Hopkins should be able to do for you. He's not much of a hitter, but he's not going to hurt you in that regard. Yeah, overall, I think I like Nugent Hopkins. I do tend to agree with you that I feel like they're going to try to fit him into the top six at least like 80% of the time, which should be good enough for him to hit these marks that we're talking about here with the 75 to 80 point projections. So I do like that. He is a little bit of, you know, this kind of mold of player who, you know, we're projecting him for 25-ish goals, around 200 shots, maybe a touch below. So he's not like the big time volume guy, the big time goal scoring guy that we really tend to covet, and tends to have the higher upside, especially for points leagues that give more weight to those kind of statistics. So there is that to factor in, but it does feel like a pretty bankable player and one that might actually slip in some leagues this year just because of the kind of off year that he did have. People look at the 103-point season as the huge outlier, and they'll say this is who he is, and he might have actually a decent bounce back to somewhere close to a point per game pace. All right, Victor Arvidsson, last member of the top six that we have here. 23 goals, 23 assists, 46 points for me. 24 goals, 30 assists, 54 points for you. This is the biggest difference that we have in our projections. So let's dig into this a little bit. Let's start here. I have him for 15 minutes overall average time on ice, and I have him for a 9.5 shooting percentage.
I've got him for just under 16, and I've got a 10.6 shooting percentage.
Okay, so you're definitely giving him a little more efficiency and a little bit more room. Is that at even strength? I have him for 13.5, or did you give him a little bit more on the power play? I have him for 1.5.
I've got him at even strength. I've got him at 14, just above 14. Yeah, so he's getting some run there.
Yeah, so basically it's even strength deployment. So you must have him a little bit more efficient than I do. I have him for 9% on ice shooting percentage. You must have regressed him more towards the Draisaitl numbers or something.
Yeah, I've got him for 9.87 at even strength.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, a little bit of that there. It does make sense. Like, Arvidsson, big-time shot generator, has always been definitely a chucker, has not converted at a high rate at any point, really, in his career. I think he had that, like, one season in Nashville where he actually had a decent shooting percentage, and everything else has been kind of subpar in that regard. But I do think that he should fit pretty well with Draisaitl on a second line. Like, I think that's a natural fit in some regards. Be interested in your take on that, Blake, as well. But he does also convert a decent clip in terms of the IPP, so he does usually factor in on the offense.
Yep.
Taking away even a little bit of that just to account for Draisaitl's gravity, I still get to a solid projection on him. But I think you're a little bit more excited about this player and even the potential that he could be next man up for the top power play.
Yeah, you know damn well I love Victor. See you at the party, Victor, the power play party, all right? When, if and when somebody gets injured on that top power play, I believe that it's going to be Victor Arvidsson on the top unit as opposed to Jeff Skinner. But that's potato-potato as well, right? Like, you could argue it either way, so I'm not, like, super bullish on that. But I do think that Arvidsson is a guy that is better defensively. Like, he's not a stalwart or anything like that. He's not an amazing defensive player, but Skinner really is bringing nothing to the table besides offense, in my opinion. Whereas Arvidsson is a more well-rounded player. So, you know, last minute of the game, you got players out there like Arvidsson can do some stuff out there, right? And to me, he's a great shooter. He gets lots of scoring chances. And he's shown some prowess on the power play, albeit for one season. But, you know, it was great. He did that in 2022-23 with LA. He had 25 power play points in just 2 minutes and 15 seconds average time on ice on the power play. So very efficient that year. I mean, that's the outlier so far. So I'm not banking on that. But I do like this player a lot. And I think he brings a little bit more to the table than Jeff Skinner. So, I mean, I've got them projected pretty close. But if I had to pick one, I'd pick Avi.
All right. A couple more players here. I have Adam Henrik. We both have Adam Henrik projected. I have him for 22 goals, 17 assists, rounding down to 38 points. You have him for only 16 goals, 14 assists, and 30 points. I think probably for me, there's just a little bit of hesitation to say that he doesn't get into the top six a few different ways throughout the season. He's an old, reliable player that I think will find his way in there at some point, even through injury, if nothing else. So I did give him a little bit of that bump. And he's been a pretty efficient player. Like, I'm for 16.1% shooting percentage. I think he can hit that in Edmonton, even if most of his minutes come on a third line. I'll toss it to you, Blake. Do you have any major Adam Henrique takes for 2024-25?
That's what you tuned into this podcast for, folks. All right, Adam Henrique all the time. No. I think a lot of his numbers last year were boosted by the deployment he was getting in Anaheim, right? Where he was prioritized a little bit. Whereas when he went to Edmonton, it was just, you're a role player, right? Like, he had 9 points in the final 22 games. I feel like that's more the player that Adam Henrique is. And I think I regressed him positively up from that, from what we saw from Adam Henrique in Edmonton. It's just not a player I'm excited about. He's a great player in real life. He is the best player in that bottom six, honestly. Like, and, you know, bring some legitimacy to that role and can do some other stuff out there. But it's just, this is like one of the only streamers you might look at for Edmonton, right? They're just going to have terrible streamers this year.
Yeah. One other player that we should mention here, didn't have him in for the projection, but I did kind of run the numbers after the fact. I have Evander Kane playing 55 games maybe this year. It's just a guess, really, at this point. I have him for 16 goals, 11 assists, 27 points. Still throwing 142 hits in that time. The injury is serious, that he's working through sports hernia surgery, yeah. I believe. So it could affect him. It could not affect him very much when he comes back. There's a lot of question about that. I think with the acquisitions they made this offseason, it really appears to me like they were preparing for life without Evander Kane being a significant portion of their top six at the very least. And so I just think that even if he does come back, he's very likely not going to skate a huge role for the Oilers this year. Like, I'm sure they'll love to have him for playoff time if he's good and healthy. Yeah. Clearly, they decided that they wanted to have Kane basically over Philip Broberg and Dylan Holloway. That was kind of the cap implications of those RFA offer sheets from the St. Louis Blues. So they did make that decision overall. So I do think Kane will be back at some point this year. I'm just really questioning whether he's going to be much more than just like a banger stream at any point this season. You got anything on Kane there, Blake?
Yeah, it's a shame because we love the metrics that Evander Kane brings, right? This guy's like a Timo Meier light, you know, but just not efficient whatsoever and getting no opportunity. And it's dwindled down since his first season in Edmonton. And with these new guys they brought in here, there's not going to be any increased opportunity here. No power play time. So yeah, it's a banger at best. And that's just not good enough, right? Especially coming off a serious injury.
All right, Matthias Ekholm, I have for 10 goals, 35 assists, 45 points. You have for 10 goals, 36 assists, 46 points. I actually really like Matthias Ekholm. I think he's going to be undervalued in drafts. 175 shots, 121 hits, 95 blocks. Like, he's going to contribute across categories. You're not going to be wowed by Ekholm's production, but he's going to play a ridiculous amount of minutes for one of the biggest offensive teams, if not the biggest in 2024-25 offensive teams in the league. And like, it's gonna be good. Like, you're gonna be pretty happy with Ekholm all season long, I think, no matter where you draft him. I'll look up his ADP, but what do you think about Ekholm this year, Blake?
Yeah, I mean, I was sold last year. This guy really delivered for me, in Kakupfel in particular. I picked him up off waivers and then I ended up holding him all year. He's just he's a solid defenseman, right? And if Bouchard goes down, Ekholm is the guy that's going to get that role and no one else. Right. So it's a nice little insurance policy as well. But even without that, like, this guy had 136 hits last year, 93 blocks, very nice, 45 points, double digit goals, access to all these beauties, just like you said. And everything under the hood is really good with this guy as well. Like, you know, the metrics were pretty damn decent last year with Ekholm. So I like the player a lot. I think he's found a perfect role on this team. And again, like I said, you get that insurance policy. Ekholm had 19 points in the final 21 games. Jeez, buddy. That was with 1 minute of power play time on ice. So he doesn't need it to get the biz.
Absolutely. I did look him up. So he's going at 108, which is a little earlier than I thought.
Yeah, maybe.
So I still think it's fair there. I think that's a...
Who's picking Ekholm at 108? Yeah. I mean, you're like, it's 108, you know, like Martin Natchez is around that time. What are you doing? Don't pick Ekholm at 108, please.
I honestly don't think it's that far-fetched. Like, he's easily locked in. And like you said, the contingent upside is actually pretty huge there in Edmonton.
You're going Ekholm at 108, and then your next pick, you're taking Adam Boqvist. All right? Say it ain't so, Nate. He's locking down D early. All right.
I don't know if I'd go that far. Evan Bouchard, someone I would go pretty far for in drafts this year. 17 goals, 61 assists, and 78 points. 19 goals, 61 assists, or 80 points for you, getting him to that mark. I mean, think this is pretty cut and dried. I had some qualms about Bouchard last year, just ascending to this role so naturally and filling it perfectly. I loved the player, I loved the underlying metrics, but I was worried that, like, we hadn't really seen proof positive that he could run this power play and be like an actual part of it. You know, like, Zach Hyman is a part of that power play, but only gets like 23 power play points out of it in my projections. But Bouchard, like, actually runs the thing from the back end and factors in on a decent amount of it. So prove me wrong last year on my projection for sure, and I've rectified things this year. He's definitely, in my mind, in the vast majority of leagues, he's a top four defenseman. I would put him in a tier with Dahlin in the second round.
How the hell do they do this? Like, you got McDavid and Drysdale, and now you got basically the third best defenseman out there for fantasy. And it's not just a product of McDavid and Drysdale. Like, this guy brings a lot to the table. He's got a bomb of a shot. Like, I don't know. I was definitely more excited about Bouchard last year than you were, but that was based a lot on what I saw in the playoffs the year previous, where he just went off on the power play. Like, and he looked good doing it. It wasn't just like, give it to McDavid and just watch him do his business. Like, this guy was making plays out there. I'm stoked for like 80 points. I don't know. Why do you hate Bouchard so much? You couldn't get him up to 80 points, Nate. What are you doing?
Yeah, it's pretty hard to project any defenseman for that, but easily he could hit 80 points and nobody would be shocked this year. Darnell Nurse, last player we'll talk about here. I have him for 10 goals, 25 assists, 35 points. You have him for 10 goals, 26 assists, 36 points. I think that Nurse is probably going to get faded in some spots, but still a bangers league beauty, over 150 hits and blocks and shots each for me this year. In my projection, they don't have anybody else. Literally everybody else has left the building. Broberg's gone. CeCe's gone. Like, there's nobody else. Nurse is going to get played. I don't care that you saw some highlights of the playoffs where he got burned. It does not matter. He's going to get played. So Darnell Nurse still going to be there, still going to have access to all these guys. He's going to have 35 points-ish, and he's going to have elite peripherals.
Yeah, not much else to add there. I hate the hate that this guy got. I hate the hate. that's profound. But yeah, like, he just got destroyed by the fan base there. And I think a lot of it was unwarranted. Like, when you're playing with Cody Ceci, like, you know, that's not a good place to be. Shout out to Cody Ceci. I know he's a big listener to the show, buddy. You're a good person. But yeah, I love the double goal again potential of Darnell Nurse and the perifs. Like, I did a Yahoo mock today, and I picked Darnell Nurse with like my third last pick or something, and it felt good. It's like, yeah, just lock up like 160 hits and 160 block, just like that, with double digit goals. Not too shabby.
For sure. Top three targets for me: Jeff Skinner, Victor Arvidsson, and Matthias Ekholm. Obviously, you know where you're picking McDavid. You know where you're picking Draisaitl. It all makes sense. Who do you have, Blake?
I got the Nuge. Ryan Nugent-Hopkins. That was before I saw his ADP was in the 60s. Nuge, you know, again, like, I've done a few mock drafts, and he's gone at over 100. Like, he just fades. So, I mean, maybe it's the drafts I'm not in. But if Nuge is around pick 90 or 100, that's an auto draft immediately. Like, this guy's going to get 30 power play points. So I love Nuge there. Victor Arvidsson, I've chosen as my second one because I think he brings more to the table, as I've said, even peripherally. A little better perifs than the old dancing boy, old little silly skater Jeff Skinner. He does that. Twirly-whirly. I don't know where I'm going with that. And then I got Matthias Ekholm as my third for the reasons that we mentioned.
All right. Let's continue on then. Let's get to the Detroit Red Wings. They do feel like, I don't know if you've seen that meme of like the guys all in combat gear, and then there's like a clown in the midst of the lineup as they're like peeking around the corner of the building. But Detroit does kind of feel like that
strays here.
A little bit, but key departures: Jake Walman is gone. Sean Shane, not Sean, Shane Gostisbehere is gone. David Perron, Robbie Fabry, Daniel Sprung. Definitely some bodies moving out here. Additions, Vladimir Tarasenko and Eric Gustafson. The additions of note, anyway, for the Red Wings this offseason. Yeah, feels like they lost some depth, at least, at the very least here, Blake.
Yeah, and we'll get into it about kind of what sort of team Detroit was this last season. But, I mean, when you lose this amount of offense and efficiency, like, I don't know. It's not they didn't really replace it in a way that I feel good about. So they're obviously expecting, you know, some development from some of the younger players, I think.
For sure. No coaching change. Derek Lalonde is back as a head coach. I am very not sold on Derek Lalonde as head coach in the NHL. The underlying stats were not good for Detroit last year. They kind of got there on a bit of a PDO bender. Mm-hmm. And by got there, I mean they didn't really get there, I guess. But as good as they were able to perform, it was more a virtue of high efficiency and not so great underlying metrics, which has me pretty worried about their ability to repeat that this year.
Yeah, it's weird because I think about the Canucks a lot, you know, every day. But, you know, they had every damn day. I love them. Except we don't have a goalie now. That's fine. But, yeah, Yuri Patera, everybody. Yes, you started going for the Vancouver Canucks. Anyways, it's a different podcast. Yeah, but they were, like, obviously the Canucks had an amazing PDO and the Red Wings had a PDO. But when I dig into the Canucks, even historically, like the last 3 years, they are an efficient team. Even under Bruce Boudreau, they were. Whereas Detroit, this was kind of a one-off. So, you know, I'm not saying they aren't an efficient team, but, like, we've only seen it, like, last season could have been an outlier, right? And if it was, that means what goes up must come down, and we're looking at less production for all their studs.
Definitely could be the case this year. Power play, first off, I think it is a question. Lalonde did not employ a true top power play exclusively last year. He did split up the power play, especially towards the end of last year, trying to get some more production out of some guys. Alex DeBrincat probably chief among those. But if you are going to run true top power play, it does feel like Larkin, DeBrincat, Kane, Lucas Raymond, like, these are the guys, right?
Yeah, I mean, when you lose a player like David Perron, who's a great power play performer, and even Daniel Sprong, the slinky, he slinked down the stairs out the door. So you've lost a couple guys that can maybe shore up that second power play and maybe make it a conversation. So, yeah, you have Tarasenko coming in here. So that is a piece, but I think they'll lean more towards a true power play, or they'll, you know, like the guys like Dylan Larkin and DeBrincat and Kane, I think are going to be fairly safe in terms of power play deployment.
Yeah, I have it that way as well. The power play quarterback is up for some debate here. You have Moritz Seider, who everybody wants to be the top power play quarterback because he brings awesome peripherals. And if he
got a beautiful head of hair.
That as well. But also, if he got all the power play time in the world, then we could get pretty excited about his fantasy potential. They did bring in Eric Gustafson, which again is one of these guys, the Shane Gostisbehere mold that just departed. Eric Gustafson fits that mold as, you know, like a third pair guy, but who's actually a pretty good power play specialist. And so it does kind of feel like they are just doing exactly what they did last year, bringing in that power play specialist to run the top power play. Is that the way you've projected it, Blake?
Yeah, sorry. When I hear the word departed, I always think of the movie. Like, what can I use you for? Remember Jack Nicholson? Do you ever see that? Oh, it's fine. All right, that's in your wheelhouse. I feel like your take last year is going to be mirrored here this year. Like Seider, they don't want him on that top power play. Like, this guy plays the hardest minutes in the NHL, basically. He's out there against the toughest competition, and he's that type of player. And I think that's sort of the role. As long as Derek Lalonde is in charge, I really think that Seider is going to get that assignment. Whereas, yeah, you bring in a guy like Gustafson, who to me is a more established version of a player like Adam Boqvist, right? Like, but he's not quite Shane Gostisbehere, is he? Like, it's right. He's kind of a middle version between those two. But I do think that, again, like you said, you bring in a player like Eric Gustafson. This is a guy that he crushed in Washington when John Carlson went down with injury. This guy had a ton of points, like something crazy, like 19 points in 21 games, lighting it up. You know, he got a hat trick that year. Like, this is a player that can do stuff offensively. He's just never been given a top power play to actually show his stuff, or at least not for a long time, you know, since he was with Chicago. So I like the player. I think this is a target for me, like in that Adam Boqvist mold, where you can get like with your last pick, you know, where your second to last pick, you can get someone like Eric Gustafson. And I think this is a lot more likely to hit.
Fair enough. Let's get into the projections here. Dylan Larkin for me, 37 goals, 47 assists, rounds down to 83 points. You have him for 36 goals, 42.5 assists, comes out to 78 points there. So I'm a little bit higher. I do like Larkin. He's quite obviously the straw that stirs the drink in Detroit. He is all that and a bag of pucks on top. I really don't think this team would be awful without Dylan Larkin, in my opinion. Like, this would be a lottery team without him. I'm pretty confident of that. And I think that he's just bankable. He doesn't rely on other people around him. If the other players around him have a good year for once, then you could really elevate him. We saw a little bit of that last year with Lucas Raymond having a pretty solid year. So I think that Larkin just feels like, again, one of these reasons to fade the top centers, and you get Larkin a little later and you're just loving life.
Yeah, he's a great center fade. Like, this guy's ADP is 86.3 on Yahoo. What the hell? So to me, that means you'll probably get him a little bit later than that. Like, you know, he's clearly the best player. Like you said, he does everything. We just got to, you know, hope that he stays healthy this year, like, which hasn't really been a problem for him. He had 68 games last year, but an 83 point pace, very nice. 26 power play points. He was set to crush, you know, or at least come close to his 31 at power play points that he got in 2022-23. So we're looking at a great power play player. He's on the ice in all situations. He plays well in all three zones. Like, this guy's a dunk. And it's just one of those guys that usually gets by me. You know what I mean? Because you're like, center only at pick, you know, 90. Like, maybe I'll like take a swing on somebody else, right? But this guy's old faithful. And he's not even old. He's 28. Like, he's a great player on, to me, not a very good team.
Totally agree. Let's talk about Alex DeBrincat, one of the more up and down players of last season. Started out with his tail on fire and ended the season just completely
tooting in our
on
faces.
Fire. I don't know. Nice. He seemed to burn up by the end of the season. 31 goals, 37 assists, 68 points is my projection. 31 goals, 39 assists, and 70 points is your projection. Explain yourself, Blake. How can you be so high on Alex DeBrincat?
I think he's going to get power play one. I think that's really the difference there. Like, you know, his year in Ottawa, this guy had 30 power play points. His year before that in Chicago, 28 power play points. His year last year with Detroit, 19 power play points. Well, Dylan Larkin's loving life with almost 30. Get DeBrincat on the power play. What the hell are we doing? I think it's going to be less of a conversation for Derek Lalonde to be like, do I put DeBrincat on there or not? Like, no, you better get DeBrincat out there and get him out there now, right? This is something you have to make work. Like, they're into this guy for, you know, I'm saying that. I'm not even looking at his contract. But, yeah, like, they're into this guy for, three more years at, like, really good money. So I think they got to get him out on the power play. And I think that's going to make all the difference in the world. Like, what did you project him power play wise, Nate?
So I have him for 3 minutes. Not quite as much as I gave to Kane and Larkin, who I both have for 3 minutes, 15 seconds. I have him for 3 minutes. I have him for an 18% shooting percentage on the power play, 59% IPP, 60 shots per 60, 14% on ice shooting percentage.
Lovely. Yeah, I'm in the wheelhouse there. Like, overall, I've got him for, you know, 22 power play points, which, that's not a crazy leap. He got 19 last year. I'm only saying three more, right? And he got, like, that'll be your 70 points from last year. So I feel like if he can really pop on the power play, like, get closer to those other power play numbers, right? Now we're looking at closer to an 80-point player. I think that's in the wheelhouse for DeBrincat, but I'm not banking on it because I don't like Detroit's roster construction or sort of their team makeup. And like you said, they're based on a lot of efficiency. So, but I feel good about 70. I don't know. That feels reasonable to me, but yeah, I thought this was such a win last year because I drafted him in a lot of spots. He just kept falling to me at a point where I thought there was value. And he started this season out so hot. Like, this guy had, you know, 40 points in the first 43 games. We're like, yes, thank you. That's excellent, Alex DeBrincat. And then he sort of tailed off. They took him off power play one, but he had power play one the first half of the season. So I'm expecting that again.
All right, Lucas Raymond next up, 24 goals, 39 assists, 63 points for me, 24 goals, 45 points, 69 points, nice for you. This is the player that we have the biggest difference on here. for myself, to get my argument out of the way here first, I personally think that Lucas Raymond is like the poster boy for negative regression.
Oh, no.
And across the entire league. So, yeah, I mean, I can dig into it a little bit more than that. The shooting percentage was high. The on-ice shooting percentage was high. The IPP was high. Everything was really high relative to his first few seasons. Young player, so, you know, you want to bake that in, that there could be a chance that, you know, it was just a natural ascension in terms of the talent, in terms of his role, and maybe he's achieving a new level. I'm not saying that's impossible, but, yeah. It everything else kind of stayed the same, and just the efficiencies totally spiked up, which is not the way that you really want to see it in terms of a legit breakout that's like actually elevating. Again, he could take a step in terms of the underlying rates there and get there on the basis of that. I'm just completely unconvinced that that's the player that Lucas Raymond is at this point. We haven't really seen it yet, in my opinion. In my opinion, last year was just a fair bit of luck.
Oh, you're full of beans, buddy. You're full of beans today. Oh, no. Lucas Raymond is going to have a great season. I mean, and I've taken him. He got 72 points last year. I've got him for less than that, I think. Yeah, 69. All right. Because when you can project for 69, you do it.
You do it.
Am I right, Nate?
Absolutely. Yeah, every time.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. But I mean, to me, that like this is a guy that shows out in those stats that I like to look at big time. And like that goes beyond the actual production that we saw out there. Like Lucas Raymond, this guy's 90th percentile in zone exits. He's 84th percentile in zone entries. He's driving the offense. He's the one carrying it in. He's the one setting up the chances, like chance contributions. He's 77th percentile. Like this guy's crushing out there. He forechecks. He Julianne's. He does that too, like we said. So I feel like this is a player that's coming into his own. He's reaching that threshold of games where players sort of take a next step. And one thing that really gives me a lot of confidence in Lucas Raymond is how he was deployed when the season was on the line by Derek Lalonde. This guy was out there in all situations. He was scoring big goals for the team, huge goals. Like he had 14 goals in the last 21 games. That's not real, right? That's not sustainable. I'm not saying that like this 19% shooting percentage that he had, I'm not expecting that again, but I do have him for 13.9% and he still came out to 69 points. So yeah, this is a player that I have taking a step next year, but it's based on more than just the chance and shot generation. It's like the way he's facilitating chances. And I do think that his deployment is going to be really solid with Dylan Larkin and potentially Alex DeBrincat there as well.
All right. Next up, JT Comfort, 19 goals, 29 assists, 47 points. If you round down for me, 19 goals, 23 assists, 42 points for you. I really don't want to spend a lot of time on JT Comfort, but I really don't think they have anybody else as the 2C. He kind of did this in Colorado where he like got thrust into a really big role and did really well because he was there. I think that it's a little bit of a similar case here where the underlying stats are never going to look good, but he's going to play with, you know, some combination of DeBrincat, Raymond, Tarasenko, and Kane, and that's going to be good enough to get him to the mid-40s in points.
Exactly. This is a guy that just gets it done by ice time. It's insane. He's a good player in real life, but for fantasy, geez. I mean, it's bottom of the barrel stuff if you're going out to pick up JT Comfort. I remember 2 years ago, I was like, you know, leading into the playoffs, the fantasy playoffs, I was like, you got to get JT Comfort. Colorado has an amazing schedule. Like Comfort, get Comfort. And he played amazing. But yeah, I mean, I don't think that's going to be happening anytime soon. All right. But he's a beautiful redheaded beauty.
That he is. Vladimir Tarasenko, next one. 21 goals, 29 assists, 50 points for me. 20 goals, 31.5 assists, rounds up to 52 points for you. I think Tarasenko, the better days have passed us by with Vladimir Tarasenko. I don't think we have the kind of upside that we used to have from this player. I don't think he was acquired for that role. He's kind of a bit of an afterthought in free agency just across the league. Mm-hmm. Like it didn't really feel like anybody was like really super pumped to go out and add Tarasenko to their squad. So I think the league kind of told us what they think of Tarasenko at this stage of his career. And I think we're both kind of in line. This is probably just a 50-point guy at this stage.
Yeah. I mean, he's won his cups. Like what the hell else does he have to do? He can just supplement, you know, the team that he's on. It's nice that he has a 2-year contract there. Like maybe they'll look to, you know, not just trade him at the deadline. Like he's been on four teams over the last 2 years or you know, and then five, including St. Louis the year before. So yeah, it's just, I remember when I first started listening to Apples and Genos, it was your projection series, like, I don't know, 2 years ago or 3 years ago. And one of the players you were really high on was Vladimir Tarasenko. And so I picked him up in a bunch of spots. He did pretty well, but it was like the first little bit where I was hearing about, you know, shots and goal per 60 and individual scoring chances of over 60, and you were explaining it. And so I always think about that when I talk about Tarasenko. That was like one of my first introductions into Apples and Genos. And look where we are now, Nate.
Look where we are now.
Yeah,
my everything.
You bet, buddy. Forever.
All right. Patrick Kane next up, 27 goals, 48 assists, 74 points there with the round down. 30.5 goals for you, 43 assists, 73.5 points. Looking pretty good. Like, he came back from what was supposed to be like a potentially career ending kind of injury, and he looked tremendous. No ill effects, basically, in terms of the underlying stats. And I think, like, Detroit knows what they have. They know that, you know, it's Patrick Kane, it's showtime. He's one of their most marketable players. He's going to be out there, and I think he's going to be a lock for 70 plus unless he gets injured again.
I love it. And this is a player you should be looking at because he's falling in drafts, right? Because of his age, because of the injury narrative surrounding him. But, you know, this is a guy similar to Crosby, and I'm not saying he's Crosby at this point in his career, but like, he knows how to adapt his game to make it work, right? And he's landed in a good spot. He's not like Tarasenko, where he's just landing in a spot and then they're kind of plugging the holes, right? This guy has a very consistent role on the team. And as long as he can stay healthy, I feel like 70 points, that seems really reasonable to me, because he's obviously a great power play performer as well.
Yeah, I think you just have to kind of account for it. These Hall of Fame caliber players are just built a little different. They're on a different trajectory than the rest of the league. You might look at the age and start to worry about some players, but the guys who are headed for the Hall of Fame who've done that for so many years, like, they're just built different, and Patrick Kane appears to be exactly that. All right, let's talk about the two defensemen here of note, Moritz Seider and Erik Gustafsson. So I think we both kind of did this fairly similarly. We split kind of the power play time a little bit evenly. So I ended up with Seider at 2.5 minutes and Gustafsson at 2 minutes, 45 seconds.
Yeah.
For me, that works out to Seider at 7 goals, 37 assists, 44 points. Gustafsson at 7 goals, 34 assists, 41 points. How did it end up for you, Blake?
Yeah, similar. A little bit lower on Seider. I had him for 8, the exact same time on ice on the power play. I have him for 8 goals and 33 assists. And then I've got Gustafsson for 6 goals and 35 assists. So they both come out to 41.2 points. Gustafsson getting the same amount of points as Seider. Is that a hot take? I don't know.
That's probably a fairly hot take. I will say, like, we can project this, and I'm not saying don't take Gustafsson with the last round pick in case he gets the top power play, in case the power play actually works really well with Kane and Larkin and company there. Definitely could. But the upside place here is still Seider. Like,
yes.
Realistically, what are you getting out of Gustafsson? Even if everything goes perfectly, he's not going to skate a huge even strength role unless there are big time injuries in Detroit there ahead of him. He's not going to contribute massively peripherally. Even the shots are not terrific. He's just going to be a guy who gets power play points, essentially. Same with Boqvist, really. You could say the same about him there. So the upside play is still Seider, because if he does get the power play, then he has 50 point upside to go along with just the massive peripherals. He's going to approach 200 hits and 200 blocks. Still not a big shot producer, but like, he's got that like Mackenzie Weegar to him, where the peripheral floor is just so solid that if and when he ever gets a top power play role, that's when he really starts to shoot up your fantasy rankings.
Yeah. I just love this player too. Like, you watch his highlight package, it's like, sheesh. This guy's he's a beast. He's a behemoth. So he's a fun player to watch. And obviously his role is pretty damn secure. I love too that he's played 82 games in all 3 seasons so far with the Wings. That's just something that I think is really, it's just nice to see. Right. But yeah, like you said, I love that take. He's the ceiling here. Gustafsson ceiling is what we've projected, right? Like, if he doesn't get power play one, then, you know, you're looking at 30 point Erik Gustafsson, right? Which we've seen already. But yeah, does Seider have that in the tank? Does he have the offense in there? I mean, I feel like they would have to get another defenseman to sort of supplement his defensive role as well, right? Like, and I don't see that on the team at this point. I don't know what Simon Edmondson is going to be like. Like, he seems more like an offensive kind of guy, but maybe a Mo Sider role or mold. I mean, without the in extreme periffs, but I mean, we'll see what happens there. But yeah, I mean, Sider is the guy you're drafting over Erik Gustafsson in every situation. But yeah, I think you're going to, you know, maybe get a little more burn with Erik Gustafsson this year in fantasy.
Yeah. I mean, Sider has not been a guy who skated anywhere close to the most even strength minutes, even in this role so far. Like, I think it's reasonable to think that he could get all the power play time and still maintain all of his other roles. It would just be, he would get then into like a 24-ish minute range potentially. And that's still not among the absolute league leaders. I don't think that's an insane thing to think is as a possibility for this year. Basic ADP right now on Yahoo, 89.4, much more reasonable than it was a year ago when everybody was super hyped about him and we were preaching some caution there. This year, you get him in the eighth round, and if he goes off, then you really have something. If he doesn't, then you still have a pretty good something. So I think the opportunity cost of Moritz Seider has drastically changed this year. And so definitely much more interested in making that bet this year than last. All right. Top three targets for me. Number one, Dylan Larkin, for the reasons I outlined. Patrick Kane, I think, will probably be undervalued in some drafts, and Moritz Seider, as we just discussed. For you, Blake?
I got Kane as my number one, again, for the value. Lucas Raymond, oh, you hate this man. And he's going to come back to bite you, buddy. Another tattoo for your collection once Lucas Raymond pops off. And then I put Erik Gustafsson on here as just a target that I'm interested in. Because Moritz Seider, where he's being drafted, like, I agree with all that you said, but I feel like players around that ADP, there's more value there to be had that I don't have to rely on something to hit. Like, I just can rely on a floor that I feel comfortable with at that ADP, as opposed to like hoping that Moritz Seider, you know, pops off. So anyways, I got Erik Gustafsson number three.
All right. Moving on to the last team of the episode. That is the Dallas Stars. Key departures: Joe Pavelski retires, Ryan Suter moves on, Yanni Hakanpaa moves on, and Radek Foxa moves on, opening up a spot in the bottom six there. Key additions here, mostly from within. Logan Stankoven obviously joined the team end of last year into the playoffs and played a pretty significant role. Maverick Bork, the AHL MVP last year, coming to the big leagues this year, basically to take over Fox's 3C role. And Matt Dumba has been added to this team as well to replace Suter's minutes, most likely. I think it's interesting. Dallas continues to have one of the better pipelines, and so they just bring all this talent up, and I don't think they're really going to miss a beat, Blake.
Yeah, everything I've read about Maverick Bork, it's like, you got this guy in the wings, and you just brought Logan Stankoven in here. Put some stank on it! Oh, yeah. And you got Wyatt Johnston, and you got Jason Robertson, and you got Rupe Hintz, like, and Thomas Harley. Jeez, like, what a ridiculous young core they have on this team. So I'm excited to see what's going on here, but like, I feel like they got rid of some forgive me, but like, dead weight. Like, Joe Pavelski, I love Joe Pavelski, Hall of Famer for sure, but like, he was noticeably slow last year, and I think that he sort of brought down his line's production. And so I think, yeah, having him outgoing and then bringing somebody new onto that line, I think is going to equal net positive for the Stars.
For sure. No coaching change here. Obviously, Pete DeBoer is back. Don't see any reason for them to change what they've been doing. It's been getting them deep into the playoffs every single year. And I don't think that will change. That's really aggressive.
Yeah, deep, way deep. I was my hypnotist. Going deep, very deep.
That was a good save. All right. Okay. Yeah. True top power play unit here for sure for the Dallas Stars. Jason Robertson, Rupe Hintz, JB Benn, Wyatt Johnston, Miro Heiskanen. Any qualms with any of that, Blake?
No, I just, please, like, get Wyatt Johnston on that top power play. I really feel like that's what's gonna happen with Pavelski leaving, but I mean, I've seen stupider things, right? Is he getting, like, if they give him the Ehlers treatment, I swear to God, I don't know. I'll have to fly down to Dallas. I'll have to, you know, pick it. I don't know. I'll write a strongly worded sign and stand outside of the stadium. I don't know. We got to get Johnston on that power play. Ben, I mean, what's your thought really quick? You think it's just a slam dunk he's on that power play? Like, kind of, you know, obviously he's aging, right? Like, this guy can't skate really, but his role, he does what he does on the power play. You think that's a lock?
I do tend to think it's a lock. He's kind of unique in that role. I guess Mason Marchment, you could argue, is somewhat of a similar player archetype. But unless they're going to really change that role on the power play, and they don't really have a strong reason to, they don't struggle for major success on the power play usually in Dallas. I just don't think they're going to try to fix something that's not particularly broken at the moment. All right. Let's talk about each of these players individually. Let's start with Roope Hintz. Still going to be the projected top line center at this point. 35 goals, 41 assists, 76 points. Rounding down there, 36 goals, 40 assists, 76 points for you. So we see this quite similarly. He had definitely a big time down year last year, Blake, but it looks like both of us believe in a little bit of a bounce back here.
Yeah, honestly, and I'm not trying to lay this all at Joe Pavelski's feet, but like, I really do think he dragged that line down, right? And not to a point that was it was bad or anything, but like he couldn't really skate very well, right? Like he just absolutely lost a step. And I think they found some success in that middle six. So they started prioritizing them, right? Where with Pavelski gone, I have this weird feeling that Dallas's top line is going to get prioritized just a bit more than they were last year. Like I'm not expecting like a nuts, you know, progression here, but I do think that they'll get a little bit more run with whoever lines up on that right side.
Yeah, that sounds good to me. I'd be all aboard for that. Baby Dry, Roope Hintz, love player. Super efficient all the time. High shooting percentage, high on ice shooting percentage. I have nothing but good things to say about the player. I do think that there's a chance that Wyatt Johnson has already outclassed him and may take more of his role. Like, if Roope Hintz comes off of the Robertson line, would be my biggest concern. I don't think that's likely. That's not the way I projected it, but that would be a concern with Roope Hintz at this point. I don't think you're going to have to like pay a really terrible price to find out with Roope Hintz right now. The average draft position on Yahoo, 89.4. So again, you're talking about a guy in the eighth round. That's definitely well worth the price of admission to find out there. Again, another reason why you can fade center in these drafts. But Roope Hintz is definitely a player that I'm open to having this year, but definitely a little bit more potential for drop off this year, just given, again, we talked about it with Draisaitl, right? The when you have these high percentages and you rely on the high percentages, if the percentages, the efficiency drops down just a little bit, it becomes a big time problem. So that's what happened to Hintz last year. I don't think that happens this year, but that coupled with the rise of Wyatt Johnson has me a little bit more worried about Hintz than I was in years past. Jason Robertson, the stud, I would still say, of this group, 36 goals, 53 assists, 89.5 points for me, 41 goals, 53 assists, 94 points for you, Blake. I think we both agree Wyatt Johnson, or Jason Robertson rather, is the guy to have. Where would you draft him? End of the second round? Is that too spicy still?
No, I feel like that's probably where he should be drafted, but I've seen him be going in the third, like early third, mid third for Jason Robertson. Jeez. I mean, how the mighty have fallen, right? This is a guy we picked in the first round last year. I picked him first round on Kekupful, and the guy tooted right in my face. Buddy, it smells like Thanksgiving dinner. What are you doing? Oh, no. I don't know where I'm going with that. But yeah, I think there's going to be a big bounce back here for J-Rob. Back up maybe 109 that he got in 2022-23 ceiling Robertson. I think we just enjoyed what we saw. The guy had 41 power play points. We were all just loving it. Edmonton was crushing on the power play, Dallas crushing on the power play. We're like, yeah, you get some power play points, no problem. Everything came crashing down, right? He still got 28 power play points last year in only 2 minutes and 46 seconds. Pete DeBoer was doing weird crap with his power play last year. So I really think that Robertson's going to get at least 3 minutes on the power play this upcoming season. And that should really help. And some of his even strength stuff, I think he's going to get a little bit more production there. So, yeah, depending on who that right winger is, and we'll talk about that in a second, but it's going to be an obvious upgrade to Joe Pavelski.
Yeah. Yeah, I will say as well, Robertson, like, this is with 18 and a half minutes average time on ice. Like, if for whatever reason, it does come true that he gets more than the 3 minutes on the power play. He gets more time at even strength. Like, there's a couple of scenarios here for Jason Robertson where he could go nuclear again and crest that 100-point mark. I don't think he's going to eclipse 109, but I do think, like, there are some upside scenarios just in time on ice alone where he could get up in that range again and make him an absolute home run pick. Average draft position on Yahoo right now, 27, so the third pick of the third round. Absolute smash at that point. All right, I have it as Tyler Seguin as the top line right wing at the moment. It is the way they went in the playoffs for a period. I think it makes the most sense just given the success of the Johnston-Ben Stankoven line for a good chunk of last year as well and what they have throughout the lineup. Open to change for sure. Like, there's definitely a few different permutations that this lineup will probably go through throughout the season. But if we're just looking at the season as a whole, trying to build a projection, I think it's the most common line that we see throughout the season. So that results in a 25 goal, 32 assist, 57.6 point projection for me. 24 goals, 29 assists, 53 points for you. We're pretty tight on our Dallas projections. I believe Seguin and Ben were the two that were the furthest apart on. I actually am higher on both Seguin and Ben personally. So yeah, I think maybe a good portion of it is that I am projecting this role a bit more for Seguin, that he's going to be on the Hintz Robertson line. Do you see that any differently, Blake?
I like the conversation. And again, that's something that you and I have talked about, and it's making me think about it, right? Like, yes, they did do that in the playoffs, but they also had Wyatt Johnston up there at times, but they did have Seguin up there more. So who knows what they're going to do? I don't know. This is something we need to watch, but I do feel like Tyler Seguin is still good to go. Like, he had a great season in a middle six role last year. I mean, granted, it was based on off of efficiency. Like, he had, his highest shooting percentage, save for like a, 2020, 2021, where he only played three games, but like, he shot 16.2% last year. That's the highest of his career. So, it's nice to have that kind of efficiency in, when you're approaching 33 years of age. Like, I don't expect that to happen again, but if he gets moved up to that top line, I think, your 57 point projection seems absolutely reasonable to me. But he's not going to get power play one. And I really think that Pete DeBoer is not going to play games with his top line as much as he did last season. Like, because I tend to think that Seguin and Wyatt Johnston are going to sort of split that time with the top line. Wyatt Johnston did get some run there in the playoffs. And I think they'll maybe want to see what he does again. I don't know, because they were playing Wyatt Johnston like 20 minutes in the playoffs. That's crazy stuff. Like, I'm excited to talk about that player.
All right, well, let's get to it then. Wyatt Johnston, we have in the sheet here as centering the second line, 33 goals, 40 assists, 73 points for me, 37.6 goals for you, 36.5 assists, 74 points. I mean, we talked about Wyatt Johnston on the show last year. I said this is the guy I want to watch on this team. I think there's a pop, definitely a potential for this player to pop. Absolutely did that and a lot more. Continuing through the playoffs, was arguably their best player in the playoffs. You talked about Dmitry Filipovich and his reels that he puts out of players' best plays. He had one for Wyatt Johnston in the playoffs.
I saw, that's an amazing video.
Yeah, just dominating players. I think people forget too that Wyatt Johnston is like not that far removed from junior hockey. The kid is 21 years old right now, and will not turn 22 until May of next year, until after the season is over. I think the sky is the limit for this player. I think might not happen in Dallas, just the way they don't give 20 plus minutes to any single player. But I think this kid has 100-point potential at some point in his career. It's all there, still ascending talent in my mind. And I don't know what else to say. I think the world of this kid, and I think that you should be really bullish on this player.
I love it. And I like your take that, if it isn't broken, don't fix it, right? Like, he works well with Logan Stankoven, who I think could have a good season in his own right this year. And Jamie Benn, obviously he's shown some chemistry there, and they don't need to really move him up on the top line. So I do think he'll have a cup of coffee there, but I was surprised to see a 73 or 74 point projection come out on Wyatt Johnston. Even though I love the player, I was still like, what? This is crazy. I mean, this is a guy who is pretty damn efficient, right? Like 14.8 shooting percentage percentage last year. I've got him for 14.1 this year. What'd you have for in conversion rate there?
14.2.
We're pretty tight. I mean, I don't know. 74 point Wyatt Johnson. Where are you drafting him, Nate?
Yeah, that is the question, right? And the nice part about it is the extra eligibility that he gives you, center right wing on Yahoo. His ADP right now is 56.5, so that puts him squarely in the middle of the fifth round there. Yeah, kind of in that Carter Verhaeghe range, I guess you could say, that we talked about a little bit before. And yeah, feels like a reasonable place to take him if you believe in the player, if you believe that what he showed us last year is real, and you think that he even has some potential to pop off beyond that, if you think he has potential to go on the top line, if you think he stays on the top power play all season long. Like, there are definitely scenarios in which Wyatt Johnson can get to a point per game or higher this year in my mind.
Who would you take? Would you take Verhaeghe or would you take Wyatt Johnston?
Yeah. At that point in the draft, I'm probably looking at what I already have. You know, if I have left wings versus right wings, I'm probably trying to balance my lineup a little bit there. But I think it's a real conversation between the two players. I think Johnson has higher potential, but Verhaeghe's probably safer. All right, let's move on. Jamie Benn, a player we have the biggest difference on, actually. I have him for 22 goals, 39 assists, 61 points. You have him for 20 goals, 34 assists, 54 points. So decent separation for us there. We can dig into it a little bit here. I don't know if you, let's start with the time on ice, I guess. I'm for 15 minutes, 15 seconds overall, and 2.5 on the power play.
Ooh, I actually got him for more time on ice, 15.5, and then I've got him for 2.5 on the power play.
Okay. So it's not there. It must be in some of the percentages. I have him for 69% IPP, nice at even strength. And I have him for 33 shots, 9.5% on ice shooting percentage.
Yeah, I got 63% IPP, 32 shots for, and then what was the other metric you mentioned there, Nate?
On ice shooting percentage on at 9.5.
Yeah, I got him actually at 10.22 at even strength. So what the hell's going on here?
Well, definitely the IPP, like 6% difference is a decent chunk at even strength for sure. That's going to significantly affect the numbers. 62% IPP on the power play?
60. Yeah, I got 60 on mine. Yeah.
Yeah, so a little bit on the power play.
Ticky-tack stuff here.
Yeah, probably like 1.5 points on the power play, 4.5 points at even strength, and then it comes out to it. Yeah, overall, I haven't really seen the decline the past couple seasons with Ben. I know, like, visually he looks slow, but I think he's got a really defined role and he's still fulfilling it. Is it a safe pick in terms of like the potential fall off for a physical forward like this and the way that they tend to fall off pretty quickly? It's definitely not. So I'm not saying like you have to draft him at this projection, but I think like at a baseline scenario, I love Wyatt Johnston. I'm projecting him to play with Wyatt Johnston a lot this year. Like I'm going to have a pretty solid projection on a guy like Jamie Benn, who seems to be still reasonably efficient, still commanding a decent chunk of the offense when he's on the ice in terms of the IPP. I just don't feel too poorly about Jamie Benn this year.
I don't know, man. I feel like things have just been dropping off slowly. You know what I mean? Like his ice time, for one, like, you know, he played 40 seconds less this year. His power play time on ice in 2022-23, he played 2 minutes 56 seconds. This last season, 2 minutes 19 seconds, right? And he still got 22 power play points. So I feel like that's massive efficiency. That's on ice shooting percentage on the power play. What if that starts going down a little bit, you know? Like, it's, I feel like there's a lot of ways that he can regress, right? And not to mention, he's a 35-year-old man, which is a spring chicken compared to yours truly, but still, you know, I feel like he's not shooting. He had the lowest shots on goal per game of his career last year, two shots on goal per game, lowest of his career. I feel like he's trending downwards, right? And you've got these exciting young players, even Mason Marchment, right? Like you said, he's kind of maybe in the mold. Like, does Mason Marchment bite into this guy's deployment a little bit? Does he get a chance on the power play, right? And what do they do with Maverick Bork? Like, I know he's placed a different position, but I just feel like this is a guy that's kind of trending towards a role player as opposed to a guy that is a big part of the offense like he has been previously.
Yep, it could be. I don't know how much I personally buy that argument, but it could happen. It's still the captain of the team, still under contract at a huge price for 3 more years.
Oh,
Like,
God.
yeah. For me, I think they're going to play him until the wheels actually fall off, not until they should
He
fall
breaks
off.
a hip.
Yeah. So, yeah, for me personally, I think I'm still relatively comfortable with him. I'm definitely comfortable with him at 158, which is his ADP on Yahoo right now. That seems like a really decent price to grab a guy who could score 60 points again this year. All right. Logan Stankoven, 21 goals, 24 assists, 45 points for me, 20 goals, 27 assists, 47 points for you. Stankoven, I think, is a really solid player. I don't know if he's got like the same kind of sky-high potential that we see for a guy like Wyatt Johnston, but I do think that 45 points, well within the range this year, with potential for more.
Yeah, I don't have much more to add here. I mean, obviously the guy, he's great. He's got offensive acumen, no question. But he's not going to get power play one. If Wyatt Johnston does go off that line, like who's he playing with? Is it going to be like Maverick Bourque as the second, or Matt Duchene? Is he going to center? Like, I don't even know. So yeah, there's some pieces here that maybe don't fit with Logan Stankoven, but I think he might be in the Calder Trophy conversation. That said, too, like this guy is really small. Like, and not that that's a huge knock on him, but I mean, there's some durability there, maybe like his ability to win battles in the corner, which wasn't a problem in the games that he played so far with the team. So it's just a guy I'm not going to be interested in drafting until I see a little bit more.
Fair enough. Let's talk about the two potential wingers on the third line, Mason Marchment, Matt Duchene. I think they have some interest for fantasy purposes at the very least as streamers. Marchment I have for 19 goals, 29 assists, 48 points. Duchene I have for 24 goals, 34 assists, 58 points. You have Marchment for 17 goals, 28 assists, 45 points, and Duchene for 20 goals, 35 assists, 55 points. Is there more here than just streamers? Do you think that, like you're saying, like, do you think Duchene is live to center a second line or get up on a second line and get more time on ice?
It's gonna be hard this year because Duchene was like a whipping boy for me last year. I'm like, no way, it's gonna fall the hell off. This guy sucks. But he doesn't suck. Clearly, like Matt Duchene had an amazing year in that role. Like 65 points in 80 games with only, just under 17 minutes average time on ice, 16 points on the power play with a 45% power play share. Like, I mean, I'm throwing numbers out at you, but the basic gist is like this guy did a lot with very little. And I don't know, like when you dig in on some of the micro stats too, this is a guy that he does that. Like he's got a lot of acumen there, offensive acumen, all the shot assists, chance assists. He's high up, a high percentile in all those things. So not to mention his zone entries, right? So I'm done sort of doubting Matt Duchene at this point. I feel like, it was a little weird to me that he signed a 1 year deal. I feel like he should have been able to parlay what he was able to do last season into maybe a contract with term a little bit, maybe to the end of his career. So that was a little bit surprising, but I think maybe he wants to stay with the Dallas Stars and he took a little bit less to make that happen. So that said too, he didn't play very well in the playoffs at all. Like this guy, yeah, he just couldn't get it done, right? 6 points in 19 games for Duchene. So which player is it? I feel like I'm not going to be drafting Duchene, but I like the profile of the player better than I did last year. And then Mason Marchment, I do think there's a chance. I think there's a chance that he can pop up and do some stuff there. But again, this is a guy that lives off efficiency, and he has in his big years. So when he's not popping off in efficiency, he's really just a streamer level. So I think I'd prioritize Duchene there, but we'll have to see what happens in training camp.
All right. Yeah, we did mention Maverick Bourque. As I mentioned, AHL MVP last year, tremendously talented player, highly ranked prospect, penciled in as the starting 3C in this lineup by most this offseason. I think he's ready for the NHL job. I mean, if you are suggesting that Wyatt Johnston could be the top line right winger a fair bit, could Maverick Bourque be the second line center and get up there, get a little bit more ice time that way, play with, maybe it's Ben and Duchene or Ben and Stankoven, maybe those guys build some chemistry. I think there are at least scenarios where we get excited about Maverick Bourque as soon as this year, but it's definitely going to be a wait and see thing. I'm not drafting Bourque anywhere.
Yeah, no way. But I mean, this guy's going to be incredible for Dynasty. And Joshy loves him. He's been talking to me a lot about Maverick Bourque. We're in a Dynasty league over at Keeping Carlson there, and he was pushing really hard, but we got sniped on Maverick Bourque. But that's a player that he's really high on. And I think, yeah, Dallas has done some amazing stuff with their pipeline here.
All right, let's talk defenders. We'll do Thomas Harley first, actually, here. I have him for 10.6 goals, 38 assists, runs up to 49 points there. You have him for 12 goals, 37 assists, 49 points there as well. So we're pretty in line. And obviously, we both have him as the second power play guy behind Miro Heiskanen. We saw what he could do with the top power play last year when Miro Heiskanen went down with injury for a period. And it was absolutely electric for fantasy purposes. I haven't projected for 140 blocks, so he does that. He's not much of a hitter, but the rest is all there, and I think he's kind of ascended to a top pairing role already. They let Suter go, they let Hakanpää go. They only really brought in Matt Dumba to replace those minutes. I think Thomas Harley is going to be leaned on a lot in this team this year.
Yeah, this is a player I'm very excited about as like my third or fourth defenseman. Like if you miss out on the D run that's happening, you know, in the third and the fourth and the fifth rounds, like Thomas Harley sitting there at whatever his ADP is, like eighth or ninth round. And this is a double digit goal guy, and he doesn't need power play one to be successful. This is a really exciting player. He reminds me of Devin Taves in that way. Like just a player that is just good to go. He's, you know, like when I dug in on some of his micro stats, shout out to Corey Schneider. He shows out amazing. And I was like, this guy, he's better than Heiskanen. And then I looked at Heiskanen and I was like, oh no, Heiskanen is elite. Right. And we'll talk about him soon. But anyways, this guy, Thomas Harley, is again, the insurance policy for Heiskanen, but he doesn't need power play one to be effective. And 15 goals last year in his third NHL season. What the hell? Like this might be something we can expect perennially.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the world of Harley, the contingent upside here is through the roof. I think he's easily rosterable going in the early part of the 13th round on Yahoo right now.
Damn.
Absolute smash at that ADP for sure. So let's talk about Heiskanen then. Also have him for 11 goals, but 54 assists, 65 points. You have him for 11 goals, 55 assists, coming out to 66 points. I think we both expect a bounce back season for Heiskanen. Obviously, did deal with injury last year. I think the power play gets better. Heiskanen has a healthy season. It'll result in a pretty solid point total. The one thing with Heiskanen is like the peripheral stats rather are really not going to help you all that much. He's going to be under 200 shots. He's going to be like at 55 hits is what I have him for, and 100 blocks, which is solid but not spectacular. So he's not really helping you out a whole lot except for the points category.
Yep, that's a really good point, and one you should remember on your draft day, right? Like, yeah, he's reliant on offense. That's what we need from Miro Heiskanen, and I think there's going to be a small bounce back on the power play. He only got 21 power play points last year. I've got him projected for 26, which I think is absolutely reasonable. I think, they're going to play more of a number one power play. Maybe not full number one power play, but I think Heiskanen is safe there, and I think he'll get more. Dallas is amazing. Like I love the players on this team, and Heiskanen's going later than he probably should. I think there's a little bit of value there. I remember last year when I was projecting defensemen, and it was my first year projecting players. I was like, you get 70 points and you get 70 points. And I think I projected Heiskanen for 70 points. So I obviously that was a bomb there, but I think 60 points is probably pretty damn reasonable for this player. And that is a very valuable defenseman for fantasy.
For sure. All right, top three targets. Number one has to be Wyatt Johnson. I can't let my boy down there. Jason Robertson, especially at that ADP in the early third round, you have to be slamming that. And then Thomas Harley. Have to be in on Harley, especially if you're anywhere near that 13th round ADP.
You got to hit it, and then you got to quit it, all right? You got to lick it before you... Oh, God, I don't know where I'm going with this. Seriously, I've had one beer, folks, and this is a... This is a 10%. I don't even know where I'm going with that. All right. I've got Jason Robertson as number one. But I mean, it's potato potato with Jason Robertson and Wyatt Johnston. I think they're both at value, or Robertson's at value. Johnston's just a player I'm excited about, the ceiling. And then I've got Thomas Harley at number three. And I think I'm going to have a lot of shares in Thomas Harley this year. I'm really excited about that player.
All right. Well, let us know which team you are most excited for of this group for 2024, 2025. Comment below. Let us know. We would love to talk more about it. If you couldn't tell by how much we've already talked about it, we do actually kind of enjoy talking about this kind of stuff. One thing before you go, I do want to mention the Apples and Geos Fantasy Guide. It comes out tomorrow, September 1st, if you're listening to this podcast on the day that it comes out. It's dropping on the Apples and Geos Patreon, link in the description. It's going to be a standalone PDF that you download, all 32 NHL team fantasy previews. There's going to be standalone articles on prop bets, on 0G, ADP values, ADP bust, sleepers. It's all in there. Blake wrote the sleepers episode, so don't at me for those takes.
God. All right. I put Adam Boquist in there. Don't worry, Nate. All right. I love a Pete.
No, but quite honestly, I think it looks phenomenal. I think that we have a lot to be proud of with it, the way that it's come together, the way that teams come together to produce it. I think that's going to provide people with a ton of value this year for their fantasy drafts, and I'm super excited to get it out there, and hopefully you all enjoy it as well. While you're here, check out the Discord. We got best ball slow drafts happening in there all the time. We're up to 47 now.
We're gonna get 50 happening this year, buddy. This is epic. Easy.
Yeah. We're easily gonna crest 50 this year for sure. If you could like, rate, review, subscribe, comment, whatever you can do on the platform you're consuming this content. Best way to help us out, help us grow this channel a little bit more with each episode. And I think, Blake, we've reached the end of everything here. I think that's all that we've got for this episode. So hopefully it brought you, the listener, some value, helped you get a little bit better at fantasy hockey today. All the advanced stats you heard today came from Natural Statric, which is a terrific free resource. Many thanks to the band there for supplying music for the podcast. Be sure to check out their Spotify as well. That's it, folks. Much love.